Hi everyone. Today let us discuss about micturition. Let us discuss it under the following headings: introduction, functional anatomy of the bladder, filling of the bladder, emptying of the bladder, higher centers of micturition, and the applied physiology. So, introduction to micturition. It is the process by which the urine formed in the kidney passes into the renal pelvis, ureter, and then the bladder, where it is accumulated and stored here, which has to be emptied periodically through the urethra later. Functional anatomy of the ureter: pair of muscular tube on either side connecting the renal pelvis with the bladder. It contains constrictions. So the one is the pelvic-ureteric junction. The another one is in the pelvic brim. Here, which when it crosses the common iliac artery, and then the uretrovesical junction when it crosses the vas deferens, and at the opening of the trigone here. Here there is an ureteric opening. Urinary bladder. So it is an hollow muscular viscous. So the neck part is the lowest part, which continues as the urethra. So the interior of the bladder, so which is irregular, loose mucosal folds. So mostly you can see the rugae here, which is a muscular fold, and then smooth firm trigone in the base, which is triangular in shape. And the internal orifice, which is located at the apex of the trigone. You can see the urethral orifice through which the ureter connects with the bladder. Structure of the bladder: it is made up of three layers: outer serous, middle smooth muscle, and the inner mucosal layer. So urothelium, which is a transitional epithelium and very important structure of the bladder. So it makes the bladder to stretch when distended with the urine. So it plays as a complete barrier for fluid and electrolytes. And it also plays a part as an osmotic barrier, and it has an glycosaminogen aminoglycan barrier, so that prevents the microbes adherence. So this glycosaminoglycan barrier plays an important role in preventing the adhesions of the microbes. Otherwise, so the bladder will be always infected. So the muscle layer, so it is an detrusor muscle, which is an important muscle which has an unique structure. So it is arranged in interlacing longitudinal, circular and spiral bundles. Action potential spreads evenly to cause the contraction of the bladder at once. So this structure helps to evenly spread the action potential, and which leads to the contraction of the bladder. Going to the urethra, it differs from male and female. So male has the longest urethra. So it has three parts in the male. So one is the prostatic part, and then membranous part, and this is the penile part. So the membranous part is surrounded by the external sphincter. Here you can see the internal sphincter. So in females, so the urethra is very short, which is 3.8 centimeters approximately. It has only two parts. One is the membranous part and the part within the vagina. So it passes through the external sphincter. Here it is, the external sphincter. It passes through the external sphincter. So this urethra lies in front of the vagina. Sphincters of the urethra. So there are two sphincters. One is the internal sphincter, another one is the external sphincter. So the internal sphincter is a circular smooth muscle fiber in the area of the neck. You can see here. So this prevents emptying up to pressure of threshold level. So the bladder empties only when the bladder reaches the threshold level. Only then the signal reaches the internal sphincter to open. Otherwise it will be closed always. The external sphincter, which surrounds the membranous urethra in the urogenital diaphragm. So this is the bulbourethral gland, and this is here is the external sphincter. So the external sphincter provides the wall entry control. Here are the difference between the external and the internal sphincter. So the internal sphincter present in the neck of the bladder, whereas the external sphincter is present in the urogenital diaphragm. The internal sphincter is smooth muscle, whereas the external smooth muscle is skeletal muscle, as it has to be a voluntary control, and it is in somatic nerve, whereas smooth muscle is an involuntary control and it is supplied by the autonomic nerve. Moving on to the innervation. So innervation is by three nerves: sympathetic, parasympathetic, and the somatic nerve. The sympathetic nerve is the hypogastric nerve. You can see that it is supplied by the lumbar segment L1, L2, and L3, which causes a relaxation of the bladder and contraction of the internal sphincter. Parasympathetic nerve supply by pelvic nerve from sacral segment S2, S3, and S4, which causes peristaltic contraction of the bladder, and also it causes the relaxation of the internal sphincter. So this is while emptying. In somatic nerve, so which is from the sacral segment S2, S3, and S4, so which causes the voluntary inhibition of the external sphincter. So it causes a contraction of the external sphincter only when the situation is favorable for urination, the external sphincter get relaxed and we pass the urine. So the sympathetic nerve is supplied by the hypogastric nerve, and the parasympathetic nerve is supplied by the pelvic nerve, and the somatic nerve, which is pudendal nerve, supplies the external sphincter. So the internal sphincter and the bladder is supplied by the hypogastric and the pelvic nerve. Pelvic nerve is a mixed nerve. So it is a principal nerve. The sensory fibers detect stretch of the bladder wall. So how far it is that stretches, the degree of the stretch is sensed, and it supplies, send the signal towards the center. So from the center, from the spinal cord and also from the higher center. So the response reaches through the efferent nerve, the motor fibers. They are the parasympathetic fibers, and it causes the contraction of the bladder by the contraction of detrusor muscle and relaxation of the internal sphincter. So internal sphincter relaxes and contraction of the bladder causes the urination. So it causes the emptying of the bladder, which is called as the nerve of emptying. Next is the hypogastric nerve or the sympathetic nerve, which is a mixed nerve. So the sensory fibers, so it senses the sensation of fullness and the pain. In addition, it also senses the pain. So the motor fibers, you can see the sympathetic innervation. From there, the motor fibers comes from the center and also from the sacral area. So the sympathetic fibers, again, it causes the relaxation of the detrusor muscle and contraction of the internal sphincter. So it also helps to prevent the reflex of the sperm. We'll see that in the next picture. So this is called as nerve of filling. So while filling the urine, you have to have the detrusor muscle relaxed and the internal sphincter has to be contracted. So if it is open, there will not be any filling. So the hypogastric nerve is called as a nerve of filling. So here you can see, so the seminal vesicle, prostate and vas deferens, from all these things the sperm gets into the urethra. So this sympathetic nerve prevents the reflex of sperm into the bladder. So this part is the posterior view of the bladder. This is so pudendal nerve, which is a somatic nerve. So the nucleus, the motor nucleus is Onnoff's nucleus, which is present in the anterior horn cell. So the urethral sensation of eminent voiding, and which causes the external sphincter contraction. So it is always contracted when there is a proper time and place for urination comes, then there will be the inhibition of this nerve. So no more contraction, the external sphincter relaxes, and then occurs the urination. So the mode of action of the innervation. So a sympathetic nerve, beta 2 receptors, so act by cyclic AMP and causes a relaxation of the smooth muscle, whereas parasympathetic nerve system, so on the bladder it has M2, M3 receptor, muscarinic receptor, so it acts by phospholipase C and inositol triphosphate, and by which it contracts the detrusor muscle. The function of the nerves that innervates the bladder. So you can see the sympathetic nerves, which causes the relaxation of the detrusor muscle and contraction of the internal sphincter, and so while filling, you can see the external sphincter is always contracted by the pudendal nerve, whereas while emptying, so the parasympathetic nerve acts, gets stimulated and contracts the detrusor muscle, relaxes the internal sphincter, and the somatic nerve causes the relaxation of the internal sphincter by inhibiting the pudendal nerve from the higher center. So you can see the receptors. So M denotes the muscarinic receptor, and alpha 1 and beta 2 receptors are adrenergic receptors. Micturition is a process by which the urinary bladder empties when filled. So it begins in the fifth month of intrauterine life. So it remains as a reflex up to 2 to 2.5 years. So then progressively they develop to control the bladder. So filling of bladder progressively till the tension of the wall rises above the threshold. This is how the filling happens by the relaxation of the detrusor muscle. Emptying of the bladder. So this is micturition reflex that empties the bladder or conscious desire of urination. Filling up of the bladder. So the walls of the ureter you can see. So the smooth muscle is arranged here in spiral, longitudinal and circular bundles in the urethra. So the peristaltic waves occur 1 to 5 times per minute, which is 2 to 3 centimeter per second. So urine is collected in the renal pelvis. Pressure increases, so that stretches the calluses, so that generates their internal pacemaker activity, initiates a peristaltic contraction beginning in the pelvis, spreading downwards along the ureter to force urine into the bladder. So it happens progressively. So the transport of urine, there is no sphincter in the ureter. Ureter has no sphincter. So the factor that prevents the backflow. So without the sphincter, the main role of the sphincter, the door is, it closes in, the, it allows the, it doesn't allow the backflow, right? So now without the sphincter, how that happens? That is because of the oblique course of the ureter and also the tone of the detrusor muscle in the bladder. So as it is relaxed, there will not be any backflow until there is any pathology involved. Factor that opens the ureter. So how the ureter is open? So that is by the peristaltic contraction. So that increases the ureter pressure. So the capacity of the bladder, there is an physiological and anatomical capacity. The physiological capacity varies from age to age. So 20 to 50 ml at birth, 200 ml at the age of 1 year, and 600 ml in the adult, that is maximum. So you can feel the desire to void at this time, but you cannot hold after 600 ml. It is not easy to hold it. Anatomical capacity. So capacity beyond which the bladder ruptures. So 1 liter, so that never reaches the 1 liter under the physiological conditions. So while reaching 1 liter, the bladder will empty. Or if there is any pathology, it will dribble and it will never reach the 1 liter capacity. Volume and pressure changes in the bladder. So when empty, intravesical pressure is equal to the intra-abdominal pressure when empty. So as it fills, that causes adaptation due to the inherent property. Plasticity, so increase in the length of the muscle while filling. So without increase in the tension of the muscle. So how is it possible? So we can know that is by law of Laplace. 2 mark la kekla. So this question is can be asked in your exams. So this law varies for different shapes. So for a spherical viscera, so the pressure is equal to 2T by R. So pressure in a spherical viscera is equal to twice the tension divided by its radius. So tension increases as the organ fills, at the same times also the radius increases. So this is plasticity. Cystometrogram. Cystometry is the technique used to demonstrate the relationship between the intravesical pressure and the volume of the bladder. Cystometrogram is a graphical recording of the pressure changes in the urinary bladder. So that is in relationship with the volume rise. So method of recording cystometrogram. So there is a double lumen catheter. So the fluid is introduced through one. So another one is the pressure is recorded through another one. So the one is that fills the bladder, another one is that records the pressure. So one for volume, one for pressure. So each time bladder is filled with 50 ml of fluid and change in the pressure is recorded. So empty bladder, so there will be having pressure of 0 centimeter of water, where when it is filled with 30 to 50 ml of urine, so 5 to 10 centimeter of water is of pressure increases, 20 to 30 milliliter of urine, so there will be another small rise in the pressure, 300 to 400 milliliter of urine, so the pressure then rises rapidly. Up to then the pressure rises slowly, so when it reaches the 400 mark, so the pressure rises rapidly. This is a normal cystometrogram. So there are three phases in it. So the phase one has two subphases, A1. So A1 up to 50 ml is filled. You can see up to 50 ml is filled, and you can see the pressure changes around 0 to 10 centimeter of water. 1B, phase 1B is when the urine is filled from 50 ml to 400 ml. So there is no much change in the pressure. So you can see the pressure remains in the 10 centimeter of water level. So this is due to the adaptation of the bladder by just relaxation of the detrusor muscle. Phase 2. So phase 2 starts when the filling goes beyond 400 ml. So the pressure changes markedly, triggering the micturition reflex. So voiding contraction rises the pressure more by 20 to 40 centimeter of water. So after 600 ml, so the urge becomes unbearable and they have to pass, otherwise the internal sphincter will open on its own. So this is how the voiding happens. So far we have seen how the bladder fills. So this is how the bladder opens. So during filling, the detrusor pressure rises by small amounts. The bladder is compliant. When the pressure reaches 15 centimeter of water, a reflex is evoked that rises the detrusor pressure and that initiates the voiding. So the pressure waves that occur during the voiding, you can see the gradually the bladder empties and the pressure decreases. Micturition reflex. So the receptors or the sensory stretch receptors, which is in the posterior urethra, and also the afferent nervus, the pelvic nerve sensory fiber, the efferent nervus, parasympathetic nerve, center is S2, S3, and S4. Stimulation by filling of bladder by urine. The effect is, the response is a contraction of the detrusor muscle and emptying of the bladder, and also relaxation of the internal sphincter. And the external sphincter is determined, the control is determined by the central, by inhibitory or the facilitatory control depending on the situation. So the emptying of the bladder happens by excitation of the stretch receptors when it reaches 300 to 400 ml of urine in the bladder. So the pelvic nerves, so that relays to the parasympathetic fibers. So from the pelvic nerve, efferent causes the contraction of the bladder. So bladder outlet pulled open, so that increase in pressure. And pudendal nerve, the external sphincter is inhibited, so so that causes relaxation of the external sphincter, then the micturition occurs. Then micturition reflex, so partial filling of bladder, reflex contraction, increase in the pressure, and relax spontaneously. Pressure fall to the baseline. So again filling of bladder. So the new cycle happens powerfully, and by fatigue the cycle stops, and again more powerful micturition reflex, and that inhibits the pudendal nerve, which causes the relaxation of the external sphincter, and then micturation happens. So at the end of the micturation, which is very important, the bladder empties in female by gravity and not by anything else, whereas in male the bladder empties by the contraction of the bulbocavernosus muscle. So moving on to the centers of the micturition, so the spinal cord, the sacral segment S2 to S4. So in the pons it has the Barrington center, midbrain, and hypothalamus, the anterior nucleus of the hypothalamus, the cerebral cortex. So the cerebral cortex, so the most importantly the motor cortex, so the superior frontal gyrus, and then the basal ganglia, limbic system. Higher center that influences the micturition, so this is in completely autonomic spinal reflex. So the inhibitory centers are the midbrain and the cerebral cortex, which inhibits the micturation by suppressing the spinal micturition center. Facilitatory centers are in pons and hypothalamus, which facilitate the micturation through the spinal centers. So central control, so normally that keeps the micturition reflex partially in the inhibited state. So this prevent the micturition reflex by tonic contraction of external sphincter till opportunity occurs. So this facilitate the micturition center to initiate micturition reflex. So when there is a proper place and situation, only then the center gives signal to inhibit the external sphincter. Till then will be always in tonic contraction. So the stretch receptor fires. So after the stretch, the parasympathetic neurons fire, the motor neurons stops firing, and you can see the smooth muscle contracts, the internal sphincter passively pulled open, and the external sphincter, you can see it is relaxed. Then the urination happened. This external sphincter relaxes only after the inhibition and when there is proper situation. It is by voluntary control. So voluntary control, contraction of the abdominal muscle, increase in the bladder pressure, urine enters into the posterior urethra. So stimulate micturition reflex, micturition occurs. So that can be interrupted voluntarily at any stage. So micturition is fully involuntary control until it reaches the external sphincter. So voiding is in voluntary control. Voluntary control of micturition. So micturation reflex is fundamentally a spinal reflex, as we have seen it so far. So it has the facilitatory and inhibitory control by the supraspinal centers, the higher centers. So the higher centers keep them always inhibited. Even micturition reflex can prevent it by continuous contraction of external urethral sphincter. When the convenient time arises, only then the higher center facilitates the sacral micturation center and initiates the micturation reflex, by which the inhibition of the external urethral sphincter occurs. Coming to the haploid physiology, so let us see them one by one. Atonic bladder, autonomous bladder, uninhibited neurogenic bladder, automatic bladder, and natural enuresis. So this is the atonic bladder when the sensory fiber is damaged. Autonomous bladder when both sensory and the motor fibers are damaged. Automatic bladder is when the spinal segment is bladder, the structure above the sacral segment is damaged. And then uninhibited neurogenic bladder when the damage is in the brainstem, that is above the spinal segments. So to start with, the sensory denervated bladder or the atonic bladder, this is due to the destruction of the sensory fibers from the urinary bladder. So this can happen in case of syphilis in tapes dorsalis. So due to the absence of sensory impulses, so the retrousser muscle loses the tone and becomes flaccid, and there will not be any contraction of the bladder, and you can see the bladder is distended and the wall is very thin and hypotonic. So So sacral posterior nerve root lesion, stretch of, so impulse of stretch cannot transmit to the center. So the over descended bladder. So overflow dribbling of urine happens. So overflow incontinence or dribbling. So bladder become thin walled, flaccid, distended and hypotonic. So this is called as the atonic bladder or tapetic bladder. Denervated or autonomous bladder. Here both the afferent and the efferent fibers are interrupted. So cauda equina lesion or section of the pelvic nerve is affected. So this is called as a decentralized bladder, as no supply of afferent and the efferent nerve. So for the short time bladder is flaccid. So later bladder becomes active and it starts expelling the content. So bladder wall is hypertrophied, shrunken bladder. So automatic or spastic neurogenic bladder. Here after complete transection of the spinal cord above the sacral segment, above the sacral segment, the urinary bladder loses the tone and fails to give the response to the micturition reflex. The voluntary control of the micturition here is lost. So whenever the bladder is filled with some urine, it is automatically evacuated. So bladder capacity is decreased and wall becomes hypertrophy. So here comes the overflow incontinence. And then next one is the uninhibited neurogenic bladder. So this is due to the lesion in the brainstem. So there is continuous excitation of spinal micturition center. The frequency of micturition is increased with a small quantity of urine collected in the bladder, which will elicit the micturition reflex. So due to the brainstem lesion, there is continuous excitation of the micturition center. So lack of inhibitory signals from the brain, so facilitatory signals passes continuously down the cord. So sacral centers are excited, which are excitable. So even the small quantity of urine causes uncontrollable micturition reflex. And then nuptial enuresis. So this is also called as bed wetting, which happens in infants and children below 3 years. So this is because of the poor development of the voluntary control of micturition. So this is because of the incomplete myelination. Myelination can happen for some kids up to 5 to 7 years of age. So this is because of the incomplete myelination of the motor nerve fibers of the bladder. So when myelination is complete, voluntary control of micturition develops and the enuresis stops in these children. If it happens beyond that age, then you have to visit your doctor. Vesicoureteral reflex. Small course of ureter in the bladder, you can see. So ureteral opening cannot occlude completely during bladder contraction. So reflex entry of urine into the ureter. So enlargement of the ureter. So that increases the pressure in the kidney and that can injure the kidney. Ureteroanal reflex. So when there is an calculi in the ureter and there is an obstruction in the ureter due to the calculi, so which causes severe pain, sympathetic reflex back to the kidney constricts the renal arterioles, reduces the renal output, avoids excess urine entry into the blocked ureter. This is called as ureterorenal reflex, protective reflex. Other applied physiology. So the urinary incontinence is the involuntary leakage of urine. Urinary retention is the lack of ability to urinate. So the micturition is inhibited. Ischuria. So it will retain the urine, but there will be some pathology to micturate. So artificial urinary sphincter, so which is used to empty the bladder. So there are, you can see there are two lumens. So one is the pressure regulating balloon and another one is the one which is in the bladder, so which controls the pressure exerted by the cuff, and this is the control pump which is implanted in the scrotum. So this contains the resistor and the valves for the transfer of the fluid from the cuff. So you can see it is cuffed around the sphincters. So when there is an issue with the sphincter to control the bladder for emptying it. In summary, so the urinary bladder fills by stretching the walls of the bladder. So it happens by three important innervations. One is by sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve, another one is the somatic nerve. So the sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve acts on the detrusor muscle and the internal sphincter, and the external sphincter gets innervation only from the somatic nerve, so which is by voluntary control, and this causes the filling, which helps in the filling. So while emptying, so the inhibitory signal comes from the center. So without the center signal, there will not be any emptying. So significant signal reaches the external sphincter that causes the relaxation of the external urethral sphincter, which progresses as voiding. So books to follow: Hindu Kurana, Genome, G.K. Pal and Gaitan. Thank you. Thank you very much for listening. If you have any doubt, so put it in the comment section or in the WhatsApp group, or personally you can message me. Follow it. Thank you.